Good afternoon, Namaskar. I, Kriti Vadhera, would like to welcome all the teachers, learners, educators, students to CIET NCERT's live phone program. And you are watching us live on PM eVidya's channel number 9. This session will be for Standard 9 students. English is the subject which we are going to discuss next 30 minutes for you. And we're joined by Dr. Amit Ranjan from CIET NCERT. I welcome you.
Thank you.
And before we begin with today's session, viewers, I would like to remind you here that if you have any kind of questions or suggestions, then please do let us know. You can dial on our toll-free number to tell us. Number would be 8800440559. If you want to watch this program on YouTube, then kindly log into NCERT's official YouTube channel by the name of NCERT Official. And there also in the live chat box, you may send all your suggestions and questions to us. Certainly, we will be taking up all of them and we'll be having a discussion on them with our expert. One more medium to contact us, to approach us, mail all your suggestions and questions to dts.class9@ciet.nic.in. So these are the various mediums to contact us, approach us. I welcome you again, Dr. Ranjan. So what's special for today's session?
Today we are doing this poem called A Legend of Northland.
Okay.
By Phoebe Carey. This is for class 9 from the book Beehive. This is a supplement to chapter 5. It's a very interesting poem. It's a legend in a ballad form. So a ballad is a song which is in narrative, which is in a story form, which is in verse form. And it's very interesting. It's a long poem, so let's not waste any more time and get into it straight away. And unlike other times when we discuss, when we read out the poem a couple of times first and then discuss the poem, this time we'll go along because it's a long poem.
Okay.
Okay. And explain it as we go.
So let's begin.
Yeah. Away, away in the Northland, where the hours of the day are few and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through, where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows, and the children look like bears cubs in their funny furry clothes. Right. So this is a legend of Northland. Northland here means the area near the Arctic, near the North Pole.
Hmm.
And so students would know that the Earth's axis is shifted, is tilted at 23 degrees. And I wouldn't go into the geographical dynamics of it, but you understand very well from your geography lessons that the summers are terribly long and so are the winters terribly long in the Arctic.
North Pole region, yeah.
In the Arctic Circle.
Yeah.
And so the winters, the days could be 18 hours, sorry, the nights could be 18 hours or 20 hours. Absolutely at the North Pole, it would be 24 hours of night for 6 months. And so in the winters, it would be endless night, 18-hour long nights. And so, as the poem says, where the hours of day are few and the nights are so long in the winter that they cannot sleep them through. So at night, we are supposed to sleep, but you possibly cannot sleep for 18 hours. And so most of your waking time would be night. And of course, this creates a lot of psychological problems as well. There are mental health issues that people face in these regions because of very long days or very long nights. And the form of the poem, as you can see, it's not a regular meter and it's rhymed in alternate lines. Only the second and the fourth line are rhymed, the first and the third are not. So this kind of rhyme scheme is ACBC. Away, away in Northland, where the hours of day are few and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through, where they harness the swift reindeer. Reindeer is the deer that you often see in images of Christmas, the one with long horns and the one pulling the sledge.
Reindeers, right.
to the sledges. And sledge is that kind of vehicle which is also mentioned at the bottom. On runners for conveying loads of passengers over snow or ice, often pulled by animals. So they are pulled by dogs, by wolves, and these are the animals that you see. This is the same sledge that you see Santa Claus riding on. And the children look like bears, cubs in their funny furry clothes. Of course, it's so cold with minus 30, minus 40 degrees centigrade temperatures that children are completely clad with furry clothes, etc. So the first two stanzas merely build up the setting, and this is how a ballad operates.
Okay.
When you tell a narrative poem, you sort of locate the poem, its settings, what the atmosphere is like, what the characters are like, and which is why it's a song which takes some amount of length. And so this is a sort of an illustration to demonstrate sledge and reindeers pulling sledge and Santa Claus sitting on his sledge, usual Christmas themed illustrations. They tell them a curious story. So in the previous stanza we saw children in furry clothes, and these children in furry clothes are told this curious story. I don't believe it is true. So here the poet is saying, I don't believe it is true, and yet you may learn a lesson if I tell the tale to you. So here the poet is making a distinction that this tale may not be true, but you can learn a lesson or two from it. How? So the poet is sort of, in a nutshell, telling what mythology is about, what legends are about. So very similar to Jatak or Panchtantra or various folk tales, Aesop's fables, where animals speak or there are moral lessons encoded. So they're not, of course, true tales, or all the things that happen in Mahabharata and Ramayana may not necessarily be historical, but there are lots of lessons to learn of what the society was like at that point of time, or what the human makeup is, because the human emotions never change. The stories from that age to this are written on basic human emotions of jealousy, anger, peace, brotherhood, etc. Once, when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below. So Saint Peter is one of the apostles of Jesus Christ. Apostle is a messenger. So there were 12 apostles of Jesus Christ, out of which Saint Peter is very important and the first. So every religion has a sort of mythology of the gate of heaven. So there is a gatekeeper of the heaven. In Islam it is Rizwan. In Christianity it is Saint Peter. So Saint Peter welcomes you to heaven, so to say. And Saint Peter was a fisherman, and there was a lot of competition on the Sea of Galilee to catch fish. And so people would go out at night and catch very few fish, because 300 boats would be out at the same time. And so Jesus asked Peter to go out in the afternoon. And Peter thought that fish don't swim in the afternoon that much in that area, but he caught 2 boatloads of fish. And so he knew he was in the presence of the Son of God, so to say. But Jesus ordained that he would be the fisherman. He would be the fisher of men, so to say. Like the shepherd, like Jesus's image is that of a shepherd. And similarly, Saint Peter is the fisher of men. So men are the fish and he's the fisher of men, so to say. And there are several other stories associated with Peter as well. And one interesting thing which youngsters must know, for example, I'll use Peter's story as an example of how to question the stories that we receive and not take them at the face value, and which is what all legends are for, to question the society at that time and to question our society at this time as well. And so it's said that Peter's daughter was paralyzed, and that Peter had paralyzed her himself, because it was said that if she was healthy, because she was very beautiful, then there would be a lot of trouble in the world, because a lot of men would be after her, and so on and so forth. And so instead of educating the men in behaving themselves, generally society...
The sacred person, I mean, paralyzed his own daughter.
This kind of legend exists in many cultures, and even now, often girls are blamed for going out in the night or wearing short clothes, etc. So instead, we need to build a culture where we understand how to respect women.
Well, thanks to you, Dr. Ranjan, for bringing this on board and, you know, and discussing these day-to-day life topics here in educational programs.
Of course, and especially on the eve of Independence Day, where independence of men and women is equally important.
Equally important, and when it comes from a man sitting here, and you know, it will be making a difference, I feel. Through these small programs only we can break these stereotypes.
Sure, we should
right?
keep talking about it, and Absolutely. Especially teenagers, the target audience for this chapter, 13-14 year olds, should understand these matters, that that there should be no gender inequality in the society and that everybody is equal. Right, let's move forward. Once when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below and walked about it preaching just as he did, you know. So when he lived, now he's in heaven, so when he lived in the world and when he went about preaching the message of Jesus, then this story happened. So now the story begins. So this is a picture of Jesus Christ giving a key to the church to Saint Peter. And this is by Pietro Perugino, and this image is in Sistine Chapel, Rome. That's just an aside. Now the story begins. He came to the door of the cottage in traveling round the earth. So Saint Peter was traveling around the world, preaching the message of Jesus, preaching the message of brotherhood and love. And he came to the house of this woman, where a little woman was making cakes and baking them on the hearth. Hearth is the floor under firewood, or the floor in front of firewood. And also written at the bottom of your screen is synecdoche. So synecdoche is where a part is used to represent the whole. So for example, she left hearth and home to work in a faraway land. Hearth is just a fireplace, but in a way it is the metaphor of house, because it's the metaphor of warmth, of cooking, of family getting together in front of a fireplace, etc. Anyway, so Saint Peter comes to this house where there's this little woman making cakes and baking them on the hearth. And being faint with fasting, for the day was almost done. So he had been roaming around all day preaching the message of Jesus Christ. And he was hungry and starving at the end of the day because he had not eaten all day. He was fasting. He asked her from her store of cakes to give him a single one. So as you know, monks ask for very little. Even Buddhist monks were supposed to just get as much grain as would fit into their palm.
Right.
And so similarly, Saint Peter asks only for one single cake to satiate his hunger so that he can carry on with his business the next day. However, here comes the turn. So she made a very little cake, but as it baking lay, she looked at it and thought it seemed too large to give away. So the woman is poem is greedy, and so instead of giving her regular cake that she's making, so cake also, you don't have to understand it in the sense of a birthday cake, but a pancake, a thin crusted cake which people eat. And so she decides to give away a small one, not the usual size she makes. But when she makes it, to her it appears that it's too big to be given. And so she gets greedy about it, that she should not give away such a large pancake. Therefore, she needed another. Needed is the action of working flour into dough. Therefore, she needed another and still a smaller one. And so she keeps reducing the size. And the more she reduces the size, to her it appears that it's too big to give to a mendicant, to a beggar. But it looked, when she turned over, as large as the first one had done. And so even though objectively she is making smaller and smaller cakes, to her they appear big. And this is a sort of a message of how we are possessive about material things and are not willing to let go, that we hoard all kinds of things. So you may have collected lots of objects, video games, let's say, and you're not willing to let go of old gadgets or whatever because you have a certain attachment to them. And this is what all religions and spiritual traditions tell us, that attachment to material things leads to this kind of sorrow. So she has the ability to help Saint Peter and give him food, at least one cake, but she just gets greedy, that this is too big. And this is also our attitude towards people, towards poor people, that a lot of people, you know, would board a rickshaw, and if he asks for 20 rupees instead of 15, you would haggle over those 5 rupees. As you go to a mall, you're willing to spend whatever they ask you. You don't haggle over there. And so this attitude of keeping a status quo with poor people is a strange attitude, and this poem clearly mentions that. And this is a legend from thousands of years old, so that's what I was saying, that the human nature does not really change. Anyway, let's carry on. She took a tiny scrap of dough and rolled and rolled it flat. So she makes it thinner also and baked it thin as a wafer. And so all of you have eaten wafers at some point of time. It's really thin, really crusty. And so the cake, which was of certain thickness, she makes it really thin to use lesser material to give to St. Peter. But she couldn't part with that. And even with the small, thin, so from a cake, it's become a little biscuit. But even that in her mind is big. And this is our condition, our difficulty to part with things, our difficulty to do charity, to understand the need of others and to live in a community collaboratively. For she said, my cakes that seem too small when I eat of them myself are yet too large to give away. And so she vocalizes it also. She says it in as many words that when she eats those cakes, they appear very small.
Very small.
And while she is making small ones now, they are appearing big.
Very big to her, yeah.
And so this is the human greed or the spirit of hoarding or attachment to things. You can use it for various situations. So she put them on the shelf. So she kept baking to feed Peter, but she thought that this is too large and she kept putting them on the shelf.
Mm.
And of course they would rot away. She lives alone, there'd be nobody to consume them. And Peter goes hungry and everybody goes hungry in the end. Then good Saint Peter grew angry. So this was enough for Saint Peter. He had been watching for a long time. And then he got angry. Who is the person in Indian mythology who gets angry? This Durvasa Rishi in Mahabharata, when he gets angry, all hell breaks loose. And also Parshuram. So Durvasa Rishi was faced with a similar situation when he came with his disciples to Draupadi, saying that they were hungry, and he brought hundreds of disciples with him, and Draupadi in exile did not have the means, so she went with one grain of rice to Krishna and dropped a drop of tear from her eyes into her hand, and Krishna said that he asked for that grain of rice, he had it, and everybody's stomach was filled, and so Durvasa Rishi ran away because he no longer felt hungry any longer. So that is a sort of an antithesis where Krishna feeds everyone through just one rice grain, and that is also the intent, that if you have the intent to feed, nobody will go hungry. If you have the intent to share amongst yourself, nobody will go hungry. Here the situation is opposite, with an equal amount of anger like Durvasa Rishi, and Durvasa Rishi is also known to curse people left, right and center in Mahabharata. And this is an exercise for you to read up stories about Durvasa and find out which episodes of Mahabharata he appears in. Then good Saint Peter grew angry, for he was hungry and faint, and surely such a woman was enough to provoke a saint. Now here as well, if you want to think through this from a feminist perspective, you can and you should. Why is there a lady in the story being cursed by the saint? Why is it not a man? So the gender role is clearly defined that it will be the woman of the house who will cook and who will also be greedy. So this also needs to be rethought, how these stories get into us, into our subconscious and formulate gender stereotypes in our mind. This could well have been a man who was cursed by Saint Peter, but that is not the case. But anyway, let's stick to the story. And he said, you are far too selfish to dwell in human form, to have both food and shelter, and fire to keep you warm. And so he says that you have everything. You have food and shelter in your fire to keep you warm, and still you are greedy, and therefore he curses her. Now you shall build as the birds do, and shall get your scanty food by boring and boring all day in hard, dry wood. And so she has her life very easy, and he curses her that from now on, the way you have made me suffer, you will also suffer, and you will have to bore your beak into the wood to find food, and you will have to work, do hard work all day long, and that is how you will get your food. Then up she went through the chimney, never speaking a word, and out of the top flew a woodpecker, for she was changed to a bird. So the curse of Saint Peter transforms her into a bird, a woodpecker, who would have to peck at the wood and get her food. She had a scarlet cap on her head, and that was left the same, but all the rest of her clothes were burned black as coal in the flame. And so the cap on her head remains the same, but all of her clothes get burnt, and now she is a bird. And every country schoolboy has seen her in the wood, where she lives in the trees till this very day, boring and boring for food. And so this is very interesting how mythology has a backstory to it about the origins of various things. So various animals and various stories are explained through backstories of curses and boons like this. Also again in Mahabharata and Ramayana, where this constantly keeps happening, that there is some sort of a justification that is given for the existence. Another very interesting story, so this is also an exercise for you to find out which kind of myths have similar explanation in Mahabharata and Ramayana, with their backstories of curses and boons, of why a certain thing appears a certain way, or why their name is a certain way. So this is the scarlet-head woodpecker. And we have discussed all these, as rhyme scheme is ABCB, only second and fourth alternate lines are rhymed. And there's alliteration, as we have discussed in previous poems, where same consonant sound keeps recurring. This is also an exercise for you to find out how many alliterations there, that they cannot sleep them through. In stanza one, for example, so the sound of the keeps coming, that they cannot sleep them through. Simile is when as or like is used to compare two entities, and the children look like bears, cubs, which we saw right at the beginning. Enjambment also we have discussed several times, right, in other lessons, where one line runs into the other, where generally in poems separate lines mean separate things, new meanings are created, but when they run on like prose to tell a story, then it's enjambment. So for example over here, once when the good Saint Peter lived in the world below and walked about it preaching just as he did, you know, he came to the door of a cottage. And also we've seen a lot of repetition. We just saw at the end, boring, 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 away, away. This creates a certain kind of effect. This creates an intensity of what the poem wants to focus on. So these are the forms, different literary devices that are used. And one last very interesting story, I'll end in 1 minute, to sort of a, as a parallel to this story, which is in this Greek book called Metamorphoses by Ovid. Which is about the origin of the word arachnid. So arachnid is anything that's got to do with spiders or arthropods or joint-legged in invertebrates. So in this story, there's Arachne, who's a woman who's a master at crafts and weaving. And okay. Athena is the god of weaving. So there's a contest between the human and the god. And unfortunately, or fortunately, it's Arachne who wins the contest, and Athena is unable to find any fault with her weaving, it's so perfect. And so Athena, the goddess, gets angry and starts beating her with a shuttle, and she beats her so hard that she decomposes, Arachne decomposes, and only her hair are left. Six hair are left and a head, which is what a spider is, a head with six legs. And so this is how there are back formations to mythological stories. And this sort of talks about, and if you understand Greek mythology, gods walked upon earth and gods are also jealous and so on and so forth. Something like our characters in our mythology also. And the goddess gets angry with this human form because she is perfect. And this also hints at the class system and the caste system that the world has been suffering for a long time. If it were to be transposed to that if somebody who's considerably low born does better than the high born, then there's a turmoil in the society. Anyway, so with that we'll end. There's a lot of food for thought for you, and yes,
indeed,
I think
a
we're
lot
in time.
Of. And before I wrap the session, Dr. Ranjan, I've just witnessed this poem. So the kind of vocabulary, the words which were used here were very, you know, easy to understand.
Yeah.
Unlike the ones we have discussed earlier.
Yeah.
So as I know you personally, and I have read a few poems written by you,
sure,
with all respect to the books you have written. So as a poet, how would you encourage these young minds, the young talented minds of nation, how they should start, you know, writing? If you could just say something about your book or the poetry collection of yours?
Sure. So my poetry collection was Find Me, Leonard Cohen, I'm Almost 30. It's a long, complicated title.
That was the first book of yours?
Yeah. So you talked about the simplicity of language in this poem. And ballads, so this is supposed to be sung. So anything that has to be sung and is folk, has to be understood by the people, has to be simple. And increasingly, as poets grow in their career, they understand the power of this simple metaphor to connect with people's hearts. And so Ghalib also in his career, the famous poet Mirza Ghalib, also in his initial career wrote difficult poems, but the shayari that is quoted of him is of the simpler variety, because it connects immediately with what people's emotions are. And so if you are aspiring to be a poet, do not go after difficult vocabulary, but go after challenging ideas. Ideas that challenge you instead of words that challenge you. Words will naturally come, they'll find their way where to fit themselves. And that is the beauty of most great writers, that they are not verbose, that their vocabulary is not very difficult. Mm-hmm. Their ideas are very difficult, very challenging. And so are the ideas in this very difficult, how to let go of your material attachments through this simple sort of allegory of the woodpecker and St. Peter.
So that was from your first book, the poetry collection of yours, Dr. Anjal. And what about the second book? I'm yet to read it. I have not given it a read. So
it's like we saw about the transformation over here of transforming from a human being to a woodpecker. And similarly, it's about transformations. It's the story of the Rani of Jhansi's lawyer, which is also kind of pertinent given that we are near the Independence Day, and how small efforts of people who are willing to make a change can go a long way in terms of. So he was John Lang, who my book is about, was a writer who who carried out these little transformations through his words. Again, the same thing, through simple, powerful words, message to the society like this poem is.
You are an inspiration, Dr. Anjan, in so many ways.
At all.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And I really thank you for giving your generous support time to time to CIIT for enhancing NCERT's resource material. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
And the viewers, this was from English Session today, and I would request you to remain connected to PME with their biggest. Next, we will be bringing webinar on ICT tools for you. Remain connected. We will be coming back just in a short while. Thank you.